Hello all, welcome to the next session in our RCC Reinforced Concrete Sections course. Here we have, I think we have covered so far up to what is the limit state method, how the load and stress is being calculated, what are the different types of cross sections in beams, what is single reinforced section, its theory and its problems, what is doubly reinforced section and its problems, and what is flanger section, how to analyze the flanger sections. Yes. So we have covered the main steel reinforcement. So far we have covered the main steel reinforcement in the beam. Okay, main steel reinforcement is like AST and AAC. You can see this green color. We know how to design this green color reinforcement so far. Okay, how many bars required at the bottom, at the top, and how to design the B and D required if somebody is giving you the moment. Now in this chapter we are going to design this. The stirrups, yellow color bars. Okay, so how to design this? Not only stirrups, so there are 3-4 different types of how to design for a shear mainly. Okay, so for this main bars, what we have designed so far is only to tackle the bending happening in the beam. Okay, I hope you remember there are two things will happen when the load is applied over the beam: shear force and bending moment. If you studied strength of materials, you would have derived a shear force diagram and bending moment diagram. There will be a shear force also. Shear force is totally different from the bending moment. Bending moment is a moment, it is a rotation. But the shear force is a force, okay? It is a tangential force directly acting over the beam. For that, we have to provide some reinforcements, right? We have to tackle that shear also. So, in this case, I have showed a simple example here. It is one form of tackling the shear is this stirrups. You can see that notes here, okay? We have to provide alternate hooks, it is just an information. But this is the way we will provide the stirrups, okay? So, this is one form of resisting the shear. So, I hope it is very clear what we are going to do. And one more thing I wish to tell it now itself, we are not going to design this stirrups itself. Stirrup is fixed, it is standard. It will be a rectangle piece which is having a hook at one end of the bar. Okay, so it is standard and diameter is mostly it will be 8 mm, 10 mm, only in that range. If it is very heavy, like a port and harbor structures, what we are bridges, we will go for 12 mm stirrups. But most of the case, it will be like a this 8 mm bars only. Okay, so then what else to design? Then what to do with the shear? Okay, so what to do with the shear is nothing but we are going to find the spacing between the stirrups. Our objective of this chapter will be to determine what should be the spacing between the stirrups. Okay, so using all the theory we are going to see, we are going to determine how to find the spacing. Okay, so design of shear means not like how we did for a beam. We are not going to provide the reinforcement. What is the dia of the bar, something, nothing. Here we are not going to change anything at all. We are just going to determine the spacing between the stirrups. And usually, if you remember, now itself I wish to tell you something. If you remember the SFD BMD diagram of UDL, consider UDL load in a simply supported beam. I hope you remember the shear force will be maximum at the supports. Correct, and it will be zero at the center. So when the shear force is maximum at the support, your stirrup spacing should be very less. Correct, like 50 mm, 70 mm, 100 mm, something like that, so that more shear force is acting, so that more stirrups are there, and you can reduce the stirrups at the center of the beam and more stirrups at the corners. Okay, that's it. So I think you can rewind the video and listen. We are going to do simply find the spacing. Okay, so we'll go inside the chapter. So I hope I told you something about shear. Shear is a force which is pushing one part of the body in one direction and another will be in the opposite direction. You can see the figure. I took this from IIT Kanpur's Google video, Google images. Okay, so you see the beam is bending. Yes, the beam is bending with the column. Okay, so you see the cracks developed in the flexural failure. The cracks are developing at the bottom, right? So this is called flexural failure, right? When the beam bend, the cracks is developing, and the cracks, if you look at the cracks, these are clearly vertical cracks. So you see the one more failure at the bottom here, bottom failure, shear failure. You see that cracks are totally inclined. If the beam is failing in shear, consider the load is applied and the beam is bending. In the bending action, there is also a inclined cracks are being developed. That inclined cracks is approximately, it will be around 45 degree. For this, I hope in every colleges, wherever you study, they would have showed you the chalk piece example. If you are applying a torsion in the chalk piece, so when you break it, you see after applying a torsion, there will be a full chalk piece. Break it, after breaking the chalk piece, you will see a 45 degree of failure, right? The chalk piece will not have cut at horizontal. There will be a 45 degree of the surface in both the failure faces. Exactly, the shear was the reason for the failure when you are applying a torsion. Okay, so this somebody would have taught you in strength of materials. So here, coming back to this theory, so far we have seen the beam bending, there will be a vertical cracks will develop when it is about to fail. Okay, if it is an under reinforced section, anything. So if it is a shear failure, this will be something look like it will be a 45 degree of failure approximately. So, and in from the mechanics of solids, that is like a strength of materials, you know the formula. Shear stress, how will you calculate? VA Y bar by IB. This formula you would have derived in strength of materials again. If you don't know, please go back to strength of materials, see that one, I think one page derivation only. So you will know how this formula came. V is a shear force. What is the shear force? It is nothing but that shear force. From the shear force diagram, you would have calculated, right? WL, WL by 2, something like that, WL by 4, all those values, that is the shear force which is coming to the beam. A is the cross-sectional area. Y bar is the centroidal distance, I is the moment of inertia, and B is the width of the section. And if you see the formula clearly, very important point is the if inversely proportional. Shear stress is inversely proportional to the width. If the B is decreasing across the cross section, shear stress will increase at that point. Okay, you should remember this point, because if you see the next, this is how the shear stress will distribute. If you see a rectangular section, this is horizontal, rectangular cross section, the shear stress will be 0 at the end and it will be maximum at the center. Don't confuse this with the shear force diagram, what you studied in strength of materials, that is for length of the beam. This is across the cross section. This across the cross section is derived from the formula tau equal to VA Y bar by IB. Using this formula, they have derived this parabolic distribution, everything. Okay. So this, if you see for the rectangular section, it is parabola starting from 0 at the top to 0 at the bottom and maximum at the neutral axis. Correct. So, but it is a singly reinforced section. You see, it stops at the center, at the neutral axis. Why? Because in singly reinforced section, we, as per the assumption of limit state method, IS456, we will ignore the concrete area below the neutral axis. Correct. The tension will be taken only by the reinforcement. So, we are assuming there is no area of concrete below. So, the parabolic distribution, the shear stress distribution will be maximum reaching at neutral axis and it will be maintained constant. That's it. Okay. Similarly, in W reinforced section, you see, there will be a small, because to the cover location, some stress, and it will be a constant at the reinforcement location and it will increase, keep on increasing because of that formula. You can see as per the Y bar formula, it will increase and it will be a constant below. And for the T section, you see the T section at the top, it is 0. And since width is changing, wherever the width is changing, there is a disturbance in the shear stress distribution. You can see, you can compare with that formula. If it is a T section, and it is homogeneous, there is no reinforcement, means the parabolic distribution will reach till the end. Okay, if it is T singly reinforced, it will reach only up the neutral axis. TW reinforced, there is a 2-3 cutting layers. You can see from the top 0 to the reinforcement, one distribution. From the reinforcement to the starting point of the web, one distribution. From the web to the neutral axis. Okay. So, please pause the video and listen and try to understand. If you have any doubt, please ask me to explain again or something, you can mail me. So, this is how it is distributed and everything is same story. Okay, if you stop and listen for 2 minutes, you will understand how it is distributed. This distribution is clearly based on the formula I showed in the previous slide. Okay, so I think this is the distribution in the, I hope you understood, this is the distribution in the cross section. Okay, I am cutting a beam and then I am seeing how the shear stress is distributing. At the center, shear stress will be maximum. At the top and bottom, it will be 0. That's it. Okay, if it is singly reinforced, as we shown here. So, what are the different types of failure can happen? So, the failure, it is a big story. Okay, types of shear failure can be discussed by the principal stress, principal strain theory, maximum shear stress theory. I hope you have studied that 5 theories. Okay, here we don't want that much detail. Okay, I will give you a short discussion. So, the shear this different types of failure has been classified based on the ratio called A by D. A is nothing but a shear span. You see the right side, that SFD BMD diagram. If I am applying a 2-point load in a simply supported beam, there will be a constant shear force from the support to the W. Correct. First, you see the SFD diagram. Only see the SFD diagram. There is a constant shear force. How much constant shear force is there up to that, then it is 0, then again a constant, okay, that is called a shear span, that is the distance is called A. Shear span is nothing but a span, length of the beam, in the length of the beam or span length, for the it has a constant shear force. And D is the effective depth of the cross section of the beam. Okay, so based on this A by D ratio, if it is 1, A by D ratio, shear span is very small, correct, a equal to d means if the shear span is very small, a by d will be 1 to 2.5, then there will be a diagonal compression failure. Then if a by d is 2.5 to 6, this is a diagonal tension failure. Diagonal tension failure is very common. You see this figure the below, that yellow color figure. You see this figure, they are in a diagonal tension, diagonal direction, diagonal, I hope you know, in a rectangle, and you draw a diagonal. Okay, something like that. If you draw a diagonal, the crack is propagating, as I showed in the previous two slides before. Shear crack failure will be protruding in 45 degree direction, correct, approximately. So that is assumed as a diagonal crack developed because of the principal tension developed in the beam, okay, because of the shear force. So we know we have provided tensile steel only to resist the bending. We don't have anything to resist this crack, correct. We have, so far we have studied single, double, everything to resist only the bending. We don't know how to resist this diagonal tension failure crack. To avoid, to cut this crack only, we are going to provide some shear reinforcement. I will show you in next coming slides. These are the four cases. You can see flexural failure will have some shear, flexural shear failure, or these four types of different failures. Okay, so next slide. And where is the critical section, where, which is the critical section for the shear? So when your support, when your support, this is the beam supported over the column, okay. So when your support is under compression, you see the right side figure, the support is under compression, correct. When the support is, support means understand what is, nothing but a column, beam is resting on a column. If your column is under compression, then not a problem, your critical section will be at d distance from the face of the column. That's what they have shown here. You see the figure clearly, critical section where the shear failure will happen, it will be happening at d distance from the face of the column, okay. So if the support is under tension, consider your column is under pure tension, okay. You cannot tell column, then it is something, some critical situation, where the force is being pulled, something like a crane rope or something, okay. So if your support, if your beam is resting on a support and that support pure tension is acting, then the critical section is exactly at the face of the column itself, okay. Exactly at the face of the column itself, that is the left side figure. If your support is under compression, the critical section is at d distance from face of the column. This is very important, okay. This is very important for the footings design. When you are going for footing design, we will discuss this same thing again. So the critical section is d distance from face of the column. When your support section, when your support is under tension, left side figure, if it is under tension, then the beam, then the critical section for the shear will be acting at the face of the column itself. That is the two difference between the figures, okay. So now we will go for design for shear. I wish to show you some example right side. I hope you know what is this figure. It is a fixed beam with UDL load. It is a shear force is distributed across the length of the beam, and a bending moment diagram is at the bottom. Okay. Remember, if there is a fixed or simply supported, doesn't matter in a shear force diagram, because fixed will create only extra moment. That is the moment, bending moment diagram will change if the beam is changing from simply supported to fixed beam. Okay. But shear force diagram, similar diagram, right? WL by 2 in left side and the negative WL by 2 in that side. So this is how the shear force will be distributed. Okay. So we need maximum stirrups near the supports and very few stirrups at the center. Again, maximum stirrups at that end. Okay. Okay. So I hope this is very clear. Next thing you should know before going for a design of shear is, there are three stresses you should know: tau V, tau C, tau C max. Okay, what is tau V? Is it is a nominal shear stress coming from outside because of you, because of me, somebody is going to apply the load over the beam, right? So if I am going to apply the load over the beam, my load will create some shear force. That shear force will be, can be divided by BD, that can be converted to tau V, right? That is the nominal shear stress. It is like somebody is giving you the tau V value. It is from externally happening. Next, shear, for that only we are going to design. Remember that tau V is the external, something coming from outside. Okay. What is tau C? Is tau C is nothing but a shear resistance, and tau C max is nothing but the maximum shear strength your concrete can take. Okay. Remember this two value. So tau C is nothing but the shear resistance. If I go next slide, this is the tau C given by your IS 450. This is the maximum standard value. So if you see this table, you don't need to memorize the value. Anyhow, most of the problems they will give you. So if you see this value, this table, left side it is 100 AST by BD. What do you mean by 100 AST by BD? 100 is for percentage, leave that. AST by BD is nothing but, BD is the total area of the beam. In that, how much AST is there? It is nothing but a percentage of steel, correct. So first column on left side is percentage of steel. So you see the percentage of steel, maximum it is 0.15 to 3% of the steel they have given for the beam. Okay, and you see the second column, third column, fourth column, everything is M15 to M40 up to seventh column. Second to seventh column heading is M15 to M40. So if you know the characteristic strength of the concrete and if you know the percentage of steel, then you can determine the tau c value. Correct. And you see the tau c value is minimum value is 0.28, maximum it is reaching up to 1 MPa. From 0.28 to maximum it is reaching 1 MPa. So your tau c, shear resistance. And one more thing you should know is this shear resistance is because if you don't have a stirrups at all, consider if I am going to hit you with a small force, you won't fall down because you already took some, you are capable to take some 5 kg of hit. If I am consider I am hitting you with 5 kg of force, you are capable, you are standing there after I am hitting also. Means that what? So you are capable of taking my 5 kg of force. Consider I am hitting you with 20 kg of force, then you are moving 2 steps back. Means what? So you couldn't able to take that 20 kg, so you are being pushed away. Correct. So what happened when I applied 5 kg? You could take it, right? So similar thing is shear resistance means without providing any type of shear reinforcement, without providing any shear reinforcement, your concrete beam and your longitudinal steels, AST and AIC only it is there. No stirrups are there. No nothing is there. Means that how much shear force it can take. It depends on its FCK value and PT, percentage of steel value. Understood? Without any shear reinforcement, how much shear force it can take? This is given in this table. From 0.2 MPa to maximum 1 MPa it can take. That's it, the story. Okay? So, this is called tau C. What is tau C max? So, without steel at all, this is the maximum shear strength any concrete can take. If it is M15, it can take only maximum to 2.5 MPa. Okay? And similarly, if it is M40, it can take up to maximum 4 MPa. Means what? Anything happen, you cannot put so much of stirrups such that to able to tackle that shear force at all. Okay, whatever, if externally somebody is going to apply some 5 MPa, some shear force, very heavy shear force is coming and the customer is telling you or external load is going to give you 5 MPa, but maximum you can take only up to 4 MPa, right? Your concrete cannot, after M40 also you cannot take more than 4 MPa at all. Your concrete will collapse. So what you have to do? You cannot design, that's it. You cannot go beyond 4 MPa at all for the shear stress. Then you have to reduce the tau V at all. You have to ask that guys to reduce the force, reduce the tau V value. Understood? So this is the maximum, whatever happens, you cannot change these values. This is the maximum shear strength of the concrete. Any chance your shear stress acting in your beam can never cross this tau C max value. That's it. Okay, so you can rewind the video and listen. There are three types of shear stress are there, tau V, tau C and tau C max. If you know this, what is these three, this chapter is very simple and it is over. We will discuss in next session how to use these formulas and we will solve some examples. Okay, this completes the how to design for a shear. Okay, so thank you.